novel, right? Yeah. One
ma'am.
second. Yeah. So modern age, 1901 to 2000. So why 1901 is marked as the beginning of modern age? In 1901, Queen Victoria died. So that era entered in 1901 and marked the modern period. Anyway, so what do you know about the modern period? Period after 1950, 1960 is known as postmodern era. Well, let me tell you, 1901 to 1950, 60 is modern era. So what are the major features of modern era? As you have all you are familiar with a British novel, I think you are familiar with the features of modern literature. Actually, works of 20th century, the first half of 20th century, they were deeply influenced by the science or philosophies. I mean theories of Sigmund Freud and Charles Darwin. And apart from that, early literature reflected the features of first two wars. So the 20th century, I mean author, they have witnessed two brutal wars, that is First World War and Second World War. So I mean, see, all these writers have made a strong break with the existing tradition from 14th century, 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th. I mean, writers of these periods, they concentrate upon either individual issues of noble classes or the issues of the period, I mean political or some other parliamentary issues. But modern writers, they concentrated upon the spiritual crisis of the people. Spiritual crisis, even though they are discussing the case of a I mean a single character, actually the single character is a representative of the entire era. So I told you the literature of the early, I mean 20th century, were deeply influenced by theories of Sigmund Freud and Charles Darwin. And yeah, so it marked an increase in industrialization and globalization. Now, what are the other characteristics features? So it is the age of anxiety. Age of anxiety, then complicated literature. See, until 19th century, you have witnessed or you have read works of those writers who usually wrote one dimensional poems or novels or dramas. But 20th century literature are popularly known as three dimensional literature, three dimensional. Actually, they don't have any kind of unity, but if you read it as a whole, you will get some kind of unity. That means unification of sensibility. Okay, so 20th century literature, or the first half of 20th century literature, you cannot see any coherence. Those literature are just a collection of fragments, okay, collection of fragments, collage literature, collage. Why they wrote in such a way? Do you have any idea why did they write in such a way? Will it be poem, drama, novel, or any genres of literature? You can see. Hello, I hope you can hear me. Hello, hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, literature in pieces, I mean work in pieces. Why? Actually, that shows the very I mean character, very feature of the I mean human beings of the 20th century, because people of the 20th century, they are also fragmented. I mean characters of the 20th century, if you come across 20th century novels, you can see characters who are highly hysteric, who are very much hysteric, paranoid, fragmented, confused characters, isn't it? If you read Jane Austen's novel, or Charles Dickens' novel, or early novels, you will not come across any confused, perplexed, I mean, hysteric characters. But if you're reading a 20th century literature poem, let it be poem or anything, you can see hysteric characters. Actually, those hysteric characters are very representative of the entire human race of the 20th century. Okay. So, obviously, like any other era, works of the, I mean, literature of the 20th century represented the features of the period. Okay. Now, yeah. So, the main characteristics of the modern literature. Individualism. I told you they gave importance to individual more than society. Through individual, actually, they are portraying the picture of the entire era. They haven't given any importance, unlike any other period, they haven't given any importance to king, queen, or noble characters. But they are very much interested in I mean, portraying the problems of, describing the problems of the modern man. Okay. So, individualism, then experimentation. So, most of the writers, that is Ezra Pound, T.S. Eliot, James Joyce, Virginia Woolf, Bernard Shaw, etc. They all have experimented with the genres. Okay. They all have, I mean, broken with the tradition that have existed in Europe. Okay, now absurdity. Absurdity in literature was the another key feature. So absurdism. What do you mean by absurdism? There is no greater meaning in any, in literature or in life. If you're trying to give some meaning for life, then you will never leave. Basically, literature or life or world. Doesn't have any fixed meaning or fixed aim, because our earth or the entire universe is a product of Big Bang, is born out of chaos. So here we are trying to bring order or unity in such a world where there is no such thing. Okay, so universe or earth or our society is basically chaotic. So there is no point in bringing any kind of order. But if you try to see it as a whole, you will get some kind of meaning. But don't strive to achieve it. So absurdity, the very meaning of life is absurd. That means there is no meaningful life. If you study British drama, obviously, you will come across in block 10 or block 9, you will study Waiting for Godot by Samuel Beckett, existential drama. So basically, life is meaningless. See, all these features have arose after those two world wars, because humanity or humankind have lost faith in, I mean, God or such type of greater existence. Because according to them, if there had been God, then these type of atrocities wouldn't have happened. That is why they, I mean, they believe that life is meaningless. One second. Now, symbolism. So, symbolism is not a new feature or a new character in 20th century now, because it's already exploited by 19th century writers. I hope you can still see the slide. If it is not possible, please do inform me. Hello? Hello?
I can see, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah. So, okay. So, symbolism is not a key feature, but 20th century writer experimented it in a new way, especially the psychological novels of Virginia Woolf. So, rather than explaining it, rather than telling something, this is that, and this is this, they showed, they express everything through symbols. Yeah, if you're reading the poems of 20th century or novels, you can see they're quite dragging. I think you're already familiar with stream of consciousness. stream of consciousness technique in novel employed by writers like Virginia Woolf. Isn't it? So what is stream of consciousness? Because human thought or human mind is not fixed, isn't it? The entire day, we are not going to think about a particular object, person, or something like that. Our thought process changes continuously. It's like a stream. So the philosopher compares our thought process to that of a stream, which is flowing continuously. That is why the writers of the early 20th century were too realistic. Now, the realism that prevailed in 19th or 18th century, this type of realism are said to be stark realism. Stark realism. Okay. Somewhat a pessimistic kind of realism. Actually, 19th century and 18th century realism were more or less like romantic realism. Somewhat imaginative or creative type, but realism that prevailed in the first half of the 20th century is called stark realism. Okay. So, if you are reading the early 20th century works, you won't find that interesting. You will find it quite dragging and all. Okay. But, and you need great patience to read such works. Anyway, they reveal great details through symbols, sometimes the tick of a clock or from the flower vase or through from the open window or animals. They render meaning to the readers. Now, formalism. I told you these writers have already, they have broken with the tradition that existed till then in Europe. So they saw it more as a craft than creativity. Okay, so they employed jargons and different types of they incorporated different phrases, language, dialogues, etc. in their work. Okay, so modern work can be, it cannot be, see nowadays we say that modern film and our film of 1970s or 80s are different from the one that we have now, isn't it? The current one that we watch are products of collage. They are collage works, isn't it? Similarly, 20th century literature, they are experimented work more rather than a product of creativity. Now, other features of modern literature, so as I have already mentioned, it is stark reality. Now, works are deeply influenced by two world wars. So works are full of irony, satire, intertextuality. I hope you know the concept of intertextuality and metafiction, fiction within a fiction. So let one more thing. None of the works in 20th century are poor. Pure. Okay. Obviously, 18th century, 17th century literature are, very much influenced by the ancient writers. But let me tell you, this one is entirely different from that. Writers of the 20th century, they employed a technique like intertextuality, metafiction, pastiche, parody, etc. So I hope you know what is what pastiche is, parody is. They are just they used a pre-existing work and they recreated in a new way, so as to satirize the tradition of the society. Okay, irony. Then intertextuality means no work is pure or original. No work in the present world is original, or we cannot exist as an individual being because every work, old work influence new work. Similarly, new one will influence the old because new one will replace the old one. So everything is connected. Even those writers who write, they they might have read the old works that might have given them some spark to write the new things. So like that, they are deeply influenced or channeled by the old work. So they will take some seeds of characters, or they will uproot some characters, or some they will take some theme or storyline from the pre-existing work and they will employ it in the new work. So such kind of literature are not pure, okay, or original. So you can see that intertextual interweaving of books. So in cinema and all, you might have seen the character that has already appeared in some other movie. Sometime he will appear in the new movie also by the same name. I think you are familiar with that. Yeah, such kind is said to be intertextual. Interweaving of text within a text. Sometimes within a story, you can see another story. You might have seen in films, they are shooting some other film. Like that. Fiction within a fiction. Let me tell you, all these things are not new. See, all these type of, these are the features of modern literature. Pastiche, parody, intertextuality, hyperreality, maximalism, etc. are not new. These are already there. Actually, these key features or techniques they have borrowed from ancient writers like 1001 Arabian Nights, isn't it? From Arabian Nights, Panchatantra stories. Actually, it is from those work these writers have borrowed the postmodern technique. See, then surrealism, existentialism, absurdism. These are philosophies, okay? Surrealism is a technique. Then magical realism. See, what do you think? Why they might have employed surrealism and magical realism in 20th century literature? Because if you say something plain in a realistic way, obviously we will have a tendency, oh, things are like that, what so much is there. But if you add spices in it, like, if certain things are difficult to digest. So in order to make it more interesting, obviously we will employ magical realism, surrealism, beyond realism. Obviously we will read it twice. Hey, what's special in it? In order to understand, we will read it twice. So we will get a better understanding about the text. Okay. So it's for that purpose they have employed stark reality. Painful reality. Okay, stark reality, then surrealism and magical realism. Isn't it? See, if you open it up, if you're disclosing something or if you are exposing something, okay, we won't have much interest in it. But you are showing partially and you are covering it, obviously we will have a tendency to open it up, isn't it? So that is the technique that that is used by the early 20th century writers. Apart from that, see, there are a lot of spaces in this literature. I told you this is a three-dimensional literature. Not that you have seen in 19th, 18th, or early 17th century. This is a bit different because here readers have an active role. Literature till 19th century, readers were passive. Okay, readers were passive, but 20th century literature, readers have an active role. Okay. Now, because most of this most of these works, they have never disclosed anything as it is to the reader, because readers will have to find answer themselves. Okay. Let me tell you, because I think you are familiar with the features of drama, story, etc. Story mountain. So every story will have a exposition. Exposition part will introduce the character, then settings. Then they will introduce, that rising action. Rising action will show the, introduce the problem. Of course, the main character will face some kind of problem, isn't it? So when he faces some kind of problem, obviously he will try to solve it, isn't it? But resolution part is not that easy. In order to solve the problem, he will have to cross many hurdles, isn't it? Many obstacles. So maybe he will undergo some changes, or he will be exposed to some reality. That part is said to be climax, isn't it? The pinnacle part where the reader is exposed some kind of knowledge, or the character really attains the maturity or growth, climax part. So once he attains that maturity, he will work for he will work to solve the problem. And once he attains resolution, or he is on the way to solve it, that part is said to be a falling action, because we, the reader, know that he will solve it somehow, isn't it? So, and the particular at a point, the character solves the problem, and resolution part, the story ends. Let it be story, drama or novel. This is the line that they use: exposition, rising action, climax, falling action, and resolution. This is the part of the storyline. So this is the normal technique or normal path used by the writers from 14th to 19th century. Obviously, there will be a problem and it will be solved by the central character. But from 20th century onwards, they started, they showed a particular type of characteristics there where they haven't solved the problem. Okay, they have left that part to the reader. See, modern movies, or movies of 18, some movies, I mean, those movies that we call art movies or award movies, obviously, cliffhanger narration. I hope you know, you're familiar with cliffhanger narration, where readers or the viewers are left with suspense. Actually, problems or the final episode is left as it is without readers will never solve such type of things. They will leave things to the readers, because readers have an active role in the modern literature. Keep that in mind. Now, so according to these writers, there is no absolute truth. Everything is relative. I told you literature of 20th century is deeply influenced by Albert Einstein, Charles Darwin, mostly influenced by science. So ending can be anything which matches with the imagination of the reader. Okay, now next one. Yeah, so we have already discussed the technique used by the modern writers, that is stream of consciousness. So stream of consciousness is a largely technique used by psychological writers. Okay, psychological writers. And another feature of this psychological writing is that all those works will be progressive, digressive in style, back and forth style. I think you are already familiar with. Please mute your mic.
Hello, Krishna.
Yeah, ma'am.
ഇന്ന് കേറാൻ പറ്റിയല്ലോ അല്ലേ? ഐ തിങ്ക് ദിസ് ഇസ് ദ ലാസ്റ്റ് ക്ലാസ് ആൻഡ് വിൽ ട്രൈ വി കൻ ഷെഡ്യൂൾ വെദർ വി കൻ ഷെഡ്യൂൾ വൺ മോർ ക്ലാസ് ഇൻ നെക്സ്റ്റ് മന്ത് ബിക്കോസ് ദിസ് മന്ത് ഷെഡ്യൂൾ ഈസ് ഓവർ. ഓക്കെ, വട്ട് അബൌട്ട് ദ ലേണേഴ്സ് സേ വട്ട് അബൌട്ട് ദ റീ രജിസ്ട്രേഷൻ ആൻഡ് ഓൾ എനി ഡൗട്ട്? We don't have academic counselor, approved academic counselor for MEG 15. MEG 15. But all the others, we have approved academic counselors. I think there is no doubt, because I have given all the details in the voice clip. Okay, and if you have any query regarding the re-registration, you can post in the group. And exam forms are not yet uploaded, so you can wait. You complete the assignment first, We will start the MEG4 next week itself. Okay. So we can have all the four courses completed by the end of this month or first week of June. Okay. So even before that, if even before completing the portions, you can start, you can write the assignments. Okay, any doubt? Am I not audible?
Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, I think there is no clearing.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
For MEG 15, the books will be available, right?
Yeah, books will be available.
And the USL. Okay.
Yeah.
Like counselor will not be there, but books and all e-learning things, everything will be available.
They will be sending the books very late. So first you have to depend on the soft copy. Later they will send it. Okay then. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, okay.
So I told you the stream of consciousness is a technique that is mostly used in psychological novels. And psychological novel has one more feature, that is this progressive digressive in narration. What is progressive digressive in narration means? See, back and forth narration. Back and forth narration means that a writer can take the reader both backward and forward. He can start from anywhere. Okay. And I told you all these works are not coherent in nature. That is progressive digressive narration. I think you are already familiar with media res, isn't it? Starting from the middle. Yeah. So that is another key feature of modern psychological novel. That is progressive digressive narration. Please note it. So instead of, So all these writers, the common theme used by all these writers is the decline of civilization, spiritual crisis or decadence. Okay. So I told you there is no clear-cut storyline for modern literature, say like a clear-cut beginning, middle or end. The problems solving part is they has given it to the reader. That part is given to the reader. Now, so and apart from that, in reader response theory next year, in reader response theory you will study that birth of the reader must be at the cost of death of the author. Okay, so the point where the author dies, it is at that point where a reader rises or reader takes birth. Okay, so in modern literature, author doesn't have much role. Got it? Till 19th century, writer was active and readers were passive. Okay, but from 20th century onwards, writer is actually passive. They are just showing it. They won't tell anything. They won't narrate anything. Actually, there is no narratology or narration in 20th century literature. They will just show you things. And we are the one who have to interpret things from that. Things from the symbols that they have shown. Okay, so birth of the reader must be at the cost of the death of the author. Okay, which you will study next year. And I told you, just like in Charles Dickens' novel and other novels like what? War and Peace, then Anna Karenina, Crime and Punishment, Victor Hugo's novel, character will appear and disappear. It is not mandatory that one character will appear throughout the story, because it is, that is why I told you this stark realism, because in life we will see some people and we are not going to see them tomorrow or day after tomorrow. Sometime you won't see them ever in our life. So like that only they portray these literature works. I mean, realistic, damn realistic to the core, stark type of realism. So disappearance of character, that is another feature. Now plot, that is not, I told you, not one-dimensional, but three-dimensional. Styles, we have already discussed. We will come across anti-heroes. Now, yeah, characteristics of modern poetry. They have used, modern writers have used simple language, daily language, dialects, jargon that has prevailed in their circle. Yes, ask me.
Ma'am, I came to know that some learners are waiting to join. Could you please let them in?
Yeah, it's not me. It's not me who's letting them in. Let me see.
Okay, ma'am.
It's controlled by IGNO, okay? University.
Okay. Let them know.
Okay. So, yeah. Another feature of modern poetry is that they have used simple language. See, it's not a type of language used by Chaucer or Spencer, or 18th century writers. Their language is simple. They even use colloquial language, commonplace language, dialogues. Sometime you will see onomatopoeia. What is onomatopoeia? Onomatopoeia is the sound, sound words, isn't it? Tick tock, ding dong, like that type. Okay, so modern poetry is mostly it is sophisticated. Only the poems of T.S. Eliot, Ezra Pound, etc., are sophisticated. But rest of the poem are not that sophisticated. It's not that refined, coarse. Okay, and you will see some kind of alienation in all these work. Why you see theme of alienation? Because modern man itself, he himself is alienated from the society, isn't it? Every man is a kind of island. Every man is an island. We won't open up, even though we have friends, relatives, a huge circle. We, within that circle, we are alone. We are so much alienated. So all these work are product of alienation, fragmentation. Another product is fragmentation. Our wasteland is a fragmented poetry. I told you, a collection of images. There won't be any connection between those images, but if you read it and after you try to analyze it, then you will get some kind of meaning. Okay, let me tell you another point. That is dissociation of sensibility. See, there are authors who tell story in a linear way, one-dimensional way, poetry in one-dimensional way. Some, even after telling story in a linear way or in a one-dimensional way, they will fail to impart, the very core theme to the readers. That is dissociation of sensibility. So dissociation of sensibility is the one of the features of bad poems or the so-called unacknowledged poems or bad poems. Okay. But according to T.S. Eliot, one should possess association of unification of sensibility. Even though the work is fragmented, or it is a collage work, after reading, it will make the reader to rethink about the work. He will put some effort from his side. There is no point in reading and understanding something that this written and says as it is to the reader. But reader must have some role. He should put some effort from his side. Isn't it? Just like a puzzle. He should be able to join that image. From that dissociated images, from that fragmented image, he should be able to associate idea. That is the first and foremost quality of a good work. Let me tell you, that is the first and foremost quality. Okay, now, these writers have openly treated taboo topics like drug addiction, crime, prostitution, etc. In their work. And Thomas Hardy, even though actually he have lived up to the third decade of the 20th century, he was largely treated as a Victorian writer because he has published his most famous works in 19th century. I mean, later half of the 19th century, he was regarded as a Victorian writer, even though he died in 1940 or 1950. Okay, so pessimistic writing, that is not new, with so many Victorian writers have employed it. But our pessimism is much more effective than the one written by the 19th century writers. Now, almost all characters in the modern works are not localized. Previous literature, Charles Dickens, Jane Austen's, their characters are localites, isn't it? I mean, characters that are specifically from a particular area, isn't it? But modern works characters are cosmopolitan. They belong to everywhere. Those men or women belong to everywhere. Okay. Now, there is no such kind of rhyming scheme or rhythm or metric pattern. Okay. Most of the writers wrote in free verse. Okay. Now, politics, problem of the age, etc. were the main topic. Now, ambiguity. Yes, ambiguity is the yet another feature. Ambiguous. I told you, it won't be clear. Some kind of, obviously, that part he has left to the reader. Now, interest in myth and especially in Greek myth. Okay, fine. Like the predecessors of 18th and 19th century, they also have shown deep interest in Greek mythology. Using those Greek myth or Greek symbolism or analogically, they told the stories or they related the present thing with that of the past. That is quite natural. That is what we call intertextuality. Because I told you, no literature or no artwork, nothing is pure. Because tradition is something like a pillar. Our literary tradition is a pillar. And the building blocks. The building blocks are the writers. So we cannot construct a pillar using a single block. Is it possible to construct a pillar using a single block? No, it is not possible. So we use many blocks to construct a pillar. So right from the down to the top. So the bottom are our ancestors or ancient writers. Like that, they will build up the pillar. So let me tell you, both the past and the present or future will, they will influence one another. So no literature is pure. It has got an interweaving character, intertextuality. Okay. So we have already discussed that. We discussed the problem of modern man, average man, lower class people, etc., etc. Anyway. Okay, so I will share in the group. You can read it in detail. Now, let's move on to baseline, T.S. Eliot. So, T.S. Eliot is an American born British poet, essays, critic, etc. So, he's considered as the popular figure of the 20th century. Even though he's an American writer, he renounced his American citizenship and became a British subject in 1927. Okay, now he proclaimed himself as a classicist in literature, royalist in politics, and Anglo-Catholic in religion. Okay, this person was awarded Nobel Prize for Literature in 1948, and his famous works are Wasteland, Polar Man, Love Songs of J. Alfred Prufrock, Ash Wednesday, etc. Now, his famous work is Murder in Cathedral that you will study in British drama. Okay. Now, let me tell you, most of the 20th century writers like Rudyard Kipling, William Butler East, T.S. Eliot, Ezra Pound, etc. are well versed in Sanskrit. See, all these writers are deeply influenced by Indian philosophies, Indian Upanishads, Sanskrit, etc. Okay. So you can see influence of Indian tradition or Eastern tradition or Upanishad in their works. Not only T.S. Eliot, but also in the works of other early 20th century writers. Okay, now, yeah. Now, important features of Eliot's poetry. So he mostly dealt with damaged psyche of reality, because we all are impaired in some way or other. We are not that perfect. Actually, our ancestors before First World War and Second World War, they had a very pleasant time. But after the Second World War, it has made a deep impact on the psychology of the people. So he has mostly dealt with damaged psyche of humanity. Now, literary history that, as I have told, history. It's a continuous process. Then changing nature of gender roles, fragmentation, myth, religious, ritual, infertility, etc. And objective correlative. Okay, let me explain objective correlative. Objective, according to T.S. Eliot, see, a writer will have some his own emotions, ideas, concept, etc. Sometimes it is not possible for the writer to convey ideas or emotion as it is to the reader. Not every writer will be able to convey that. Okay. But in order to convey such kind of realities or concepts to the reader, he has to use images. Images. It is the images of some kind of thought process that conveys such kind of deep reality to the readers. So the essential quality of a work is objective correlative. Objective correlative. I told you a good work must possess association of sensibility or unification of sensibility. They should be able to unify. Doesn't matter how much fragmented the work is, but after reading the work, reader must be able to unify it. That is the first quality. The second quality, author should be able to render his emotion, his true emotion and feeling to the reader. And it works through a set of ideas or images, certain images do that role for the author. Okay, now let me tell you, a good author, obviously, he will have feelings, ideas, etc. But he is compared to a factory. Okay, author is a factory, and his feelings, emotions, okay, his emotion or ideas, etc., are catalyst. Chemicals of his ideas are chemicals. I mean, the idea in author's mind are chemicals, and his emotion is a catalyst. So we know that in a chemical process, catalyst will be remain inert, isn't it? Inactive or inert, they will simply accelerate the process, isn't it? Similarly, emotion is okay. Emotion is the one that fuels, the work. But a good writer, he shouldn't be involved too much in the writing. Okay, when he writes, his product and the writer will be one. But at the end of the work, at the completion of the work, it should not be that much involved in the writing. It should be the work and the reader, and the work and the writer should be two separate entity. A good author will not reflect his personal stuff in the writing, even though he uses it for the compilation of the work. At the completion, it shouldn't be reflected, or his personal things shouldn't be there in the work. Okay. Now, so we have seen imagistic. Obviously, Eliot's poetry is full of images, allusions, suggestive language, very complex, multidimensional. Then, just like Shakespeare, William Shakespeare, he too has violated the three unity, unity of action, unity of place, and unity of what? Time, isn't it? So this person in Wasteland, I told you Wasteland is not a coherent poem. It doesn't tell you a story about a particular character, something like that. Actually, the time span of the poem starts from BC and to the present age. Okay. Yeah. Now, coming to Wasteland. Coming to Wasteland. Yeah. Are you trying to ask me something? Yes. Okay. Wasteland, widely recognized as one of the most important poems of the 20th century. Published in 1922. So the poem has got 434 lines. Actually, at first there were more than 700 lines. It was concise by Ezra Pound. Okay, we will discuss later. In United Kingdom, it first appeared in Criterion magazine. In United States, it appeared in Dial magazine. Okay, so the first line of the poem, April is the cruelest month. Actually, it works as a parody to Chaucer's, Canterbury Tales, prologue to Canterbury Tales, because in Chaucer's prologue to Canterbury Tale, April is the sweetest month, isn't it? But here in Wasteland, he says that April is the cruelest month. And he ends this poem with the mantra, Sanskrit mantra, Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. And this particular poem combines the myth of Holy Grail, Fisher King, and Winx of contemporary British society. Okay, anyway, I told you it comprises Western philosophy as well as Eastern. Okay, so you can see Buddhist philosophy here, Hindu influence of Hindu Upanishads and all. Yeah. And there are many voices in this poem, different voices. Let me tell you, the chief narrator is Tiresias, but you will not, you cannot recognize him until you reach the third section of the poem. Because here, the protagonist is unnamed. He's not given any name. But when you reach third section only, you will relate that image to that of Tiresias. I hope you know who Tiresias is, isn't it? Tiresias is an ancient, Apollonian prophet. A prophet at Delphi. Actually, he's a blind prophet. Let me tell you, once there had been a heated argument between Zeus and Hera. Zeus and Hera, they were quarreling over a topic that who is having more pleasure during lovemaking while they were having sex. Okay, so Tiresias, he had stood with Zeus and he said that it is woman who's having more pleasure during lovemaking. So Hera, at that moment itself, struck him blind. Okay, Hera made him blind, Tiresias. And she also caused him to be, Tiresias is not neither, Tiresias is neither man nor woman. Okay, actually he has unified both sexes in him. So one more thing. So anyway, Zeus has blessed him with longevity and prophecy. This person can see past, present, and future. Even though he is blind, Tiresias is a cosmopolitan. Okay, just like our modern characters. Those people who have done the literature, degree in English literature, I think those people are familiar with Tiresias, Oedipus Rex and all, isn't it? So, I told you, Tiresias is an ancient Greek prophet. Prophet at Apollo's temple. Okay, he's a devotee of Apollo. He's the one who has made oracles. who has given oracles. Okay, divine reading to the kings, queen, etc. Anyway, that person belonged to all ages. Okay, he's a cosmopolitan. I told you why he has become blind. There had been a quarrel between Zeus and Hera struck him blind, but Zeus has blessed him with prophecy and longevity. Okay. Now, anyway, I told you this poem is divided into five sections. Okay, first section is Burial of Dead, introduces diverse themes of disillusionment and despair. Second section is Game of Chess. Now third section is Fire Sermon. Fire Sermon, anyway, that heading is borrowed from Buddha's Eightfold Path. It is also influenced by Saint Augustine's Western asceticism. Now, fourth section, title is Death by Water. Fifth section is What Thunder Said. Let me tell you, fourth session and fifth session are deeply influenced by third, fourth, and fifth. Are deeply influenced by Indian philosophies. Now, it also has an epigraph, a Greek epitaph. The epigraph is written in both languages, that is Latin and in Greek. It is taken from satiric form of Petronius. Now, about Wasteland, let's see the cultural background of Wasteland. So I told you 20th century, Europe has witnessed increase in urbanization, industrialization. Now, entire Europe was, even though it was urbanized and industrialized, it was spiritually declined. Okay, Europe was devastated by the First World War. It has witnessed many bloodshed, revolution. People were basically very unsettled. Okay, they have given value only for money. So there had been, just like Charles Darwin's philosophy, there had been a struggle for survival, and they have, their moral part were loose. Okay. Now, as I have told, all the characters are alienated. Not only the characters of the modern literature, but individuals were also alienated. Now, loss of spiritual values. Most of the characters of the 20th century were actually devoid of moral and ethical values. These topics we have already discussed, hysteric and paranoid characters. Now, structure of the work. So I told you this Wasteland is a social satire. Social satire, it's a social commentary. Okay, so even though this is a fragmented work, it is Tiresias, the narrator, the blind narrator, who brings some kind of unification. He is the one who brings unification of sensibility, because he is the cosmopolitan narrator. Let me tell you, Tiresias is the cosmopolitan narrator. Anyway, there are many classical symbols, images. The work includes the myth of Holy Grail, fertility cults. Let me tell you, here during Dasera and Fora and some other festivals, we will make the effigy of gods. Thereafter the festival, we will immerse them in water, isn't it? Similarly, there are similar type of festivals in Europe during agricultural festival. Agricultural festivals, they will make the effigies of the gods like Adonis, Attis, and artists. Okay, after the festival, they will immerse the effigy in water. Let me tell you, in all religions, water has got a primary role. That is in Christianity. It is after baptism. What we do in baptism? They will immerse the baby in holy water. Similarly, water is holy, isn't it? So death by water actually cleanses all sins of a person. So that is the most virtuous death one can ever have. That is death by water. Actually, death by water is a kind of rebirth. Now, cinematographic technique. Alien has employed cinematographic technique, and the technique is called montage. M-O-N-T-A-G-E. M-O-N-T-A-G-E, montage. The cinematic graphic technique is first employed in Wasteland. Just like, see, movie. How a movie is directed. They will make so many shots. They will take so many shots. After that, they will edit it. They will join it, isn't it? Similarly, Wasteland is also compiled like that. He has written many fragmented things. After that only, he has joined it. Just like a movie only, he has created Wasteland. Then the poem is esoteric. What do you mean by esoteric? Esoteric means the poem has got a lot of terms. I mean, professional terms. Only a professional or a pedant or only a scholar can understand the poem in a meaningful way or in a deep, significant way. Okay, this is why it's an esoteric poem. Not only poems of T.S. Eliot are esoteric, almost poems of early first half of the 20th century writers are esoteric, because all these writers are scholars. They are well versed in Eastern and Western philosophies. Okay, so they have used their own terms or those erudite scholastic terms in their work. So there are no clear-cut characters, as I told you. This poem doesn't have a normal plot development, or it is not linearly written. It is a three-dimensional work. Now, ambiguity, confusion are a part of this poem. Then other themes, love, betrayed, fermity, betrayed, rebirth, offered, etc. Other theme. Then modernist elements. Discuss Wasteland as a modern work. If you're getting such an essay question, you cannot write, obviously you will not be able to write the summary of Wasteland. But how will you substantiate this work as a modern poem? So what are the modernist elements? Pictures of disintegrated world, broken images, pessimism, frustration, mythical elements, surrealism, magical realism, imagism. So entire thing will provide some kind of unity to the work. Even though you don't have anything to relate with each other, after reading the poem, you will get some kind of unity. So art will provide the unity that is lost in the modern world. Modern world is chaotic. It's essentially chaotic. If you're searching for the meaning, you will not get the meaning. But here, writers are offering art has a solution to unify it. Only art. And they are also giving a solution that turn towards West, turning toward the Eastern philosophy. Okay, because they have already understood that because of sex or because of crime or materialistic attitude, they have lost their spiritual values. So their writers are offering a solution to the readers, Western readers, to turn towards the East. So has to attain salvation. Okay. Now, source of myth in the poem. I told you this is an intertextual work. Being a modern work, this is not pure. This is not a pure work. It is intertextual. It has borrowed materials from here and there, like from Bible, Dante's Inferno, Virgil's Aeneid, Ovid's Metamorphosis, Milton's Paradise Lost. The chief source of work are Jesse L. Western. Please note it. The chief sources of work are Jesse L. Western's From Ritual to Romance, published in 1920, and James Frazer's Golden Bow, Study in Magic and Religion. Okay, now another mythical elements are, I told you, agricultural festival. I mean, the part of immersing effigies in water, that is the myth of fertility. Now, another one is the myth of Fisher King and Holy Grail are the other sources of the poem. Now, use of myth. I think you are already familiar with the myth of Holy Grail. So this is the Holy Grail used by Jesus Christ after his crucifixion. His disciple used the grail to collect his blood, isn't it? So whoever is possessing this grail, they will be immortal. They will be devoid of any kind of worries or spiritual or moral degradation. Okay. So yeah, let me tell you, Fisher King and his soldiers, due to their evil ways, their land has become barren. Not only the land, the king has become impotent. He had got a lethal wound. So day by day, his country is declining. So the solution offered is to bring that Holy Grail. So all his knight had set forth to bring that Holy Grail. Okay. So, yeah. And I also told you that this poem has got an epigraph. It is taken from Satyricon, written by Petronius. Now, it is a story of Sibyl of Cumae. Let me tell you, Sibyl of Cumae is a nymph. Once she was, she got the blessing of Apollo. So she forgot to ask him that she wanted to be young as long as she lived. Instead, she asked for immortality. Anyway, Apollo has blessed her with the boon of immortality, but she has become an immortal. And what happened is she has become really small. She has lived through many centuries, but she has lost her youth, and now she has become very small. Now she really wanted to die because there is no point in living with such a worn out body, isn't it? If you want to live, then you should have that zest and spirit. But she doesn't have such zest or spirit. She has lost it. So now she really wanted to die. So when the poem ends, you can see that when the children ask her, "What do you want?" She says that, "I want to die. I want to die." So the poem tells the theme, death in life. Even though people of 20th century are living, we are living, isn't it? We all are living. But we are actually dead inside. We are actually dead inside. So all those characters that appear in this poem, they tell a greater truth that we are dead inside. We are living dead. Okay. Anyway, please note this point. That is the epigraph, taken from Satyricon, written by Petronicus. It is through the tale of Sibyl of Cumae that he relates that greater reality of dead in life. Now, that we have seen, decline of major themes, decline of civilization, degeneration of love and sex. So love and sex have lost its importance, their importance in modern society. Okay, only money is important. Yeah, impossibility of recovering meaning in life, spiritual degeneration. Then this poem is dedicated to Ezra Pound. I told you the poem is originally more than 700 lines. It is Ezra Pound who cut-sized this poem into 434 lines. So this poem is dedicated to Ezra Pound. And see, epigraph, I told you epigraph is written in both in Latin and Greek. And the Pound is termed as, Ezra Pound in this poem is termed as Il miglior fabbro, which means a better craftsman. So who is the craftsman of wasteland? Even though Eliot has written this poem, And who is known as the craftsman of this poem? Ezra Pound. Okay. It is taken from Dante's Purgatorio. That is a Latin work. Okay. This is a Latin term. Il Migrio Fabro is a Latin term, which means a better craftsman. Now, about the protagonist of this poem. We have already seen that he is a Theban, a Greek prophet. His name is Tiresias, protagonist of classical mythology. He has both male and female features. Old man with wrinkle, female breast. Now, what are the characteristics of the protagonist? Let's see. He is blind, but he has got a powerful inner vision. He is immortal, prophetic, bisexual. He belongs to all ages. Okay, so he is what he sees. See, he's traveling through different ages in this. If you're reading this poem, he's traveling through different ages and he is exposing to different things. So whatever thing he sees, that becomes the substance of this poem. Okay. Now, are you people still there? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. So, once again, I'm telling you, you should not these two work, Golden Bow and Ritual to Romance. These two are the two primary sources of the wasteland. Okay. Other minor things are tarot cards, tarot reading. I think you are familiar, some of you are familiar with tarot reading, card reading, isn't it? Tarot reading. Then Dandi, Divine Comedy, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. It's from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. T.S. Eliot has borrowed the last three lines. Obviously, some statements have been taken from Bible. Okay, now let's discuss the first few lines of the poem. I told you this is an esoteric poem. Only a scholar who is well-versed in both philosophies, Western and Eastern, can render the deep, significant meaning of this poem. Let me tell you. Okay. Dedicated to Ezra Pound. Il Migrio Fabro, which means better craftsman. The first section is burial of dead. April is the cruelest month. Breeding lilacs out of the dead. Land mixing, memory, desire, stirring dull roots with spring, rain. Winter kept us warm. Covering earth is forgetful snow. Feeding a little life with dried tubers. Summer surprised us. Coming over Stanburgers with a shower of rain, we stopped in the colonnade and went on in sunlight into the Hofgarten and drank coffee and talked for an hour. So let me tell you the burial of dead. So this part is taken from the Anglican, from the that very title. T.S. Eliot owes to the very burial ceremony of the Anglican churches in England, isn't it? Burial ceremony. We bury the dead people after, isn't it? That part is taken from Christian philosophy. Okay. Now, April is the cruelest month. I told you the first line works as a parody to Canterbury Tales. Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. Because there, April is very... Because during Chaucer's time, England was very beautiful. Isn't it? Divide of all kind of bloodshed wars. See, just during... When it's in the 20th century, witness to world wars, isn't it? Bloodshed revolutions and all. So they are not familiar with such type of circumstance. That is why Chaucer has mentioned it as sweetest month. But here, after World War, after Battle of Bore, Miley and all, people have become, they have grown disillusioned with their life. So it is mentioned as April is the cruelest month. We know that it is the spring season, isn't it? First month in the spring season. So normally it's a period of rebirth, life. Spring season is the period of life and rebirth, isn't it? There is a poem in English, I think you are familiar with that, by Shelley. If winter comes, can spring be far behind? Isn't it? After winter season, after a long winter season, there comes summer, then spring season, isn't it? But after summer season, in this modern world, we don't have any kind of enjoyment, spiritual. Like, why don't we are able to enjoy things. Even though we have all kind of amenities, facilities, we have money, facilities, everything. But still, why are we not able to enjoy things around us? Because we are spiritually dead, isn't it? That is why. April is the coolest month, even though it is the time of rebirth, spiritually, it is not possible. Lilacs out of the dead and land, lilacs out of the dead land, mixing memories of desire, steering dull roots with the spring rain. So during winter season, and almost all trees or seeds will lay underground, isn't it? Seeds will buried underground during summer and spring season. They will come out, isn't it? Leaves will come out. But here T.S. Eliot says that these leaves are actually dead inside. He presents lilac as a symbol of dead in life. Or lilac is a symbol of death. After the death, we will keep wreath upon the body of a person, isn't it? Dead body of the person. Similarly, lilac is nothing but a wreath. Wreath for the entire mankind. So, rebirth is not possible in the present situation. So, winter kept us warm. During winter season, we remain indoors, isn't it? We remain indoors. Seeds, plants, etc. remain buried underground. So they are actually warm during winter season, isn't it? In previous literature, in previous work, actually, all those writers were really hopeful. Of course, there will be a better dawn or a bright future, etc. But in this literature, he says that we cannot hope for a better future. The rebirth is impossible because spiritually we have declined. We don't have any kind of such hope. Earth in forgetful snow, feeding a little life with bright tubers. Summer surprised us, coming over the Sternberges. So Sternberges is a lake in Germany. Okay. With a shower of rain, we stopped in the colonnade. So let me tell you, in section 1, burial of dead, there are so many collages, so many images, many images. He presents 5 images in this section. 5 images are in this section. So narrator, that is Tiresias. Let me tell you, in the first part, when you read the poem for the first time, first, second and third section, you will never realize that the narrator is Tiresias. But let me tell you, a little life with bright tubers. So someone is narrating the very situation of that spring season. Even though in the spring season, they are not really happy. They don't see anything new or full of spirit or enthusiasm. They don't feel enthusiastic. Why? They are dead inside. Okay. Now they are walking through the Sternberges, by the side of Sternberges. It's a lake in Germany. The shower of rain. So they are having spring rain. Rainfall that they get we get during spring season. We stop in the colonnade. Colonnade means column of pine trees, or evergreen trees. Went on in sunlight into the Hof Garden and drank coffee and talked for an hour. So our narrator is now sitting with a highborn lady. After walking by the side of Sternberges or taking a walk in the middle of through the column of pine trees, now they have sat for a coffee and they talk for an hour. First image. Okay. Now, that is the first section. I told you there are many sessions. So first session, it deals with the burial of dead. I told you, he owes the title to the Anglican churches. The title, Fertility Gods in Praises, Golden Bow. So in this case, death is, in every case, death is followed by rebirth. But in this section, he says that rebirth is very doubtful. Now, we have already seen the first image. Now, the second image, the second image is that he talks to the son of Adam. And he says that, see, wherever he looks, he can only see bones, ashes. There is no sign of rebirth. He's talking to son of Adam. Son of Adam means any person. It can be any person who is son of Adam. Human beings, right? So second image, son of Adam. First image, I told you, Tiresias is talking to a highborn lady. Narrator is talking to a highborn lady. And they are taking a walk in the Hofgart at Munich. Then he talks to the son of Adam. And the third image is he's talking to Mary. Mary, let me tell you, Mary is a Russian, not Mary, sorry, it's Maria. Maria is a Russian girl. Okay. And she says that her parents come from Lithuania. She is a Russian, but she is not really Russian because her parents come from Lithuania. And she says that she is really a German. What does it say about her? It shows the rootlessness, identity crisis. The third image. I'm telling you the third image. I hope it is getting registered. First image, Tyrish is talking to that highborn lady. They are taking a walk through Hofgarten at Munich. And they have discussed the climate, even though everything is, they are having a pleasant climate, they are not able to enjoy it because they are dead inside. The second image is, he's generally talking, he's addressing the son of Adam, that is human beings in general. Because wherever Tiresias looks, he cannot see anything fruitful. He just sees dead and barren areas. Okay. So there, it is impossible to have a rebirth. Now, the third thing is Maria. He meets a lady named Maria. Maria is a Russian. Then she says that she is not actually Russian because her parents come from Lithuania and she is a German. This shows rootlessness, identity crisis. Okay. Now the fourth image. Now, the fourth image is taken from Wagner's Tristan and Isolde. Okay. So here he presents two lovers. Okay. So the lover is meeting his beloved after a long time. She has decorated herself with hyacinth flowers. Okay. So let me tell you, hyacinth is actually a Greek youth who was loved by Apollo but accidentally got killed by him. From his blood drop only, hyacinth flower, hyacinth plant has sprouted. Okay. So let me tell you, the girl has ornamented or decorated herself with hyacinth. That is why she is known as Hyacinth Girl. Lover has gifted her hyacinth flowers, but she is not happy. Her face is described as cheerless. She is not that cheerful. You can see that cheerlessness in her. Cheerlessness is reflected on her face. That shows that love is dead. Okay. So third image is the episode of Hyacinth Girl. Hyacinth, please note that point. Mary. Okay. Now, the fourth image is that of the card reader, Madame Seistress. Madame Seistress is a tarot, is a clairvoyant, one who reads cards. Okay, so Tiresias approaches her. Actually, he's passing through different ages. He's just traveling through different ages. Now, he met Madam Soistress, she is a clairvoyant. She is the one who reads cards. So I think you're already, some of you are already familiar with the card reading. So it's a 70, it's a deck of 78 cards. So many cards are there. One second. Hold on a second. Yes, yeah, three of swords, then 10 of wands, 7 of wands, 8 of wands, 8 of pentacles. So many cards are there. Okay, card reading, tarot reading. So anyway, this lady is having a mischievous pack of cards. That means she is not real. Okay, so when she has drawn cards for Tiresias, she has drawn cards like the card of Hangman, Belladonna, then a blank image, then One Night Merchant, and she has also drawn the card of a Phoenician sailor who is drowning. Okay, so she told Tiresias that he is in a difficult situation. He will have a death by water. Who? Tiresias will have a death by water. Now, the last image, the last episode of the first section is he continues his journey, and the place is termed as Andrea City. Let me tell you, the Andrea City is London. Throughout the poem, London has been addressed as Andrea City. So when he looked, he can see only crowd of ghosts walking here and there. Why? It's instead of saying he saw a city crowded with people, he says that populated by ghosts. Okay, this London city is populated by ghosts. Okay, now he meets a character called Stetten. So he identifies, narrator identifies this person is someone from the Battle of Mylae. I mean, the first war fought between Rome and Carthage. Okay, so Tiresias, or our narrator, identified Stetson, a character from the Battle of Mylae, the first war fought between Rome and Carthage. I mean, the war that took place before BC. Okay, so narrator asks him if the corpse he planted in his garden has begun to sprout and bloom, but no response is given. Okay, so in this part, here he says that rebirth is impossible. If during winter season, in Shelley's winter season, winter winds are said to be both destroyer and preserver, because during winter season, wind carries the seeds and it dries away the dead leaves, isn't it? When a fruitful thing comes, it has to make, dead things have to make space for the, more lively things or energetic things, isn't it? So winter winds preserves the seeds, and during spring season, it will sprout. But it is impossible in the present scenario or the present situation. So I repeat, burial of dead consists of five images. First one, the highborn lady and Tiresias, narrator, they are walking through the Hof Garden at Munich, and they are drinking coffee and they discuss about the present situation that April is the cruelest month. They are not able to rejoice at the rebirth of the season because they are dead inside. And the second, narrator is speaking to the son of Adam, that is human being in general. Wherever he looks, he cannot see anything fruitful. He just sees the barren land everywhere, full of skeleton. Okay. Now, full of thorny plants, dry lands. That means it shows the sterility, infertility of the land as well as, I mean, land has rendered waste. That means both the human beings and the land have become infertile. Now, the third part is of the the lady named Mary. Sorry, it's not Mary, Maria. Okay, Maria. She says that she is a Russian, but she is not actually Russian. Her parents come from Lithuania, but she is German. It shows that she is facing identity crisis. Almost all modern men face identity crisis, isn't it? Because we are colonized. See, Indians, if we ask, if someone asks us what language you speak, we say our mother tongue, isn't it? But we learn in a different language. Most of us have studied in English medium and we learn our own history or philosophy or our cultural background in a different alien language, isn't it? We study about ourselves in English, not in Malayalam or not in Hindi or not in some other language. Of course, there are Hindi medium, Malayalam medium and Tamil medium, but we think that speaking English is more standard and we'll get more reputation when we speak in front of others, isn't it? So that is why we are facing some kind of identity crisis, and we even think that all the things that made in Germany or France, Italy, America are more standard, more exotic, elite than compared to us, isn't it? Why? And we are examining ourselves or things that is particularly belong to our country using Western parameters. That means we are hybridized products. We all are facing identity crisis. Anyway, that image is shown through Maria. Okay. Now, the third symbol is from taken from Hyacinth Girl. Lovers. He presents two lovers here. Hyacinth girl, she has decorated herself with hyacinth flowers gifted by her boyfriend, but she is not actually happy. Even though her lover is with her, she is not happy. That shows the cheerlessness in love. Present love is not, love affair is not full of hope or happiness, but it is futile. Okay, now fourth image is that of the Madame Seistress. I told you, Sorceress is a clairvoyant. She is having a deck of mischievous cards, somewhat 78 cards. And like I said, she has drawn cards for our Tiresias narrator. He came to her to see, it's a great irony, let me tell you, because this person has got a peculiar ability to see. He can see future and past. Okay. Tiresias came to Madame Seistress, but just for the sake of fun. Maybe it's just for the sake of fun. Then he has drawn cards for him. Merchant card, blank card, then Lady Belladonna's card, like that. Then finally she draws a card of Phoenician sailor who was drawn to death. Then she says that narrator or the Tiresias will have a death by water. And the last episode in Burial of Dead is, let me tell you, Tiresias comes to London, which is called as Unreal City, and the city is crowded by ghosts. That means people who are dead inside. And he recognized a person named Stetson. So our narrator is very much familiar with Stetson because they too have fought in Battle of Mylae, first war fought with the Rome and Carthage. And he asked him, has the corpse he had planted in the garden, have they sprouted? It is impossible, isn't it? No corpse will come back to life again. We know that. So that shows the very futility of the age, infertility of the age. So that's all about the first part. And the second part, game of chess. Hello, are you people still there? Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
It's a long poem. It's a long poem. It's the modern epic. Wasteland is a modern epic. Okay. Now, the game of chess. Second section of this poem. Game of chess is taken from Woman, Beware of Woman from Thomas Middleton play. Okay. The second section, the title of the second section is taken from Thomas Middleton's play, Women, Beware of Women. Okay, let me tell you the second section. The theme of Game of Chess is sterility. Once again, sterility and meaninglessness of life without love in wasteland. Not only our earth is a wasteland, but also human beings who are living on are also waste. That is what is conveyed in this section. So there are two scenes in Game of Chess. Actually, those two scenes present contrast between, life in rich and rich setting and life in a low and vulgar setting. So when the Game of Chess opens, he describes a highborn lady who is sitting in a thorn-like chair. In her lavish room, her room is decorated with curtains, and the curtains have the tapestries showing scenes from Greek mythology of Philomela. Okay, so let me tell you, it's Troilus and Cressida. One second, I forgot the name of the Shakespearean drama. Let me tell you, so that myth of Philomela and King Tiresias. So actually Philomela is the sister-in-law of King Tiresias. So while they have gone for a hunting to forest, King Tiresias has raped Philomela. So in order to keep that as a secret, he cuts the tongue of Philomela and she dies and she becomes a songbird. And he returns to the palace. Okay. So anyway, even though he has cut the tongue of Philomela, his wife comes to know about the entire episode when Philomela, who has now become a songbird, has revealed everything to her sister. That means the wife of the king. So she became very furious because her sister was brutally raped and killed by her husband. So what she did is she killed her own children. King Tiresias' wife killed her own children and she fed the king. Okay, she fed the king with the flesh of his children. Okay, so that is what is told in that episode. Anyway, that mythology is used here. Okay, that means love is devoid of any kind of true feeling. It's full of lust. That is why T.S. Eliot has used this episode here. He's simply relating, the picture. highborn lady's room has got many curtains. That curtain has got the tapestry or the embroideries of Philomela, who is raped by King Tiresias. I'm only telling that story, okay? So let me tell you. The scene says that lady is not at all happy. Even though she is very rich, she is well groomed, she always complains of the bad nerves. Even though after having, after making love, she's not feeling happy. She's very anxious. Okay. And she complains to her lover. Lover is least bothered about her anxiety. He's not at all after having pleasure. Okay, done. It's done. He's not that attentive to his beloved. That means the present love stories are devoid of true feelings, but it's full of lust. Now, the second part of the game of chess. Yes. It is set in a London bar, a lowly London bar. A lady named Lil, she is discussing to her friend that her husband will come soon from war. Her husband is a military man, and she says that she's very much worried, because she's getting aged. Her appearance has badly changed because of the pills, abortion pills she has taken. See, she already has 5 children. And her husband will insist on having sex without any precaution. So several times she has become pregnant, and in order to avoid the pregnancy, she has taken many pills. Anyway, she has lost all the interest in love making. She is simply doing it because she has to keep her husband. So these two things, these two stories, actually expose. I mean the what? I mean says that both characters are not satisfied with their partners. Now, anyway, this section closes with a line from Hamlet, central character Ophelia. We know that those people who are familiar with William Shakespeare's Hamlet, Ophelia, the heroine of the drama, she commits suicide. And she says before her before committing suicide, she says goodnight to everyone. Similarly, the section closes with a goodnight song from Ophelia. So let me tell you, I already told you this work is intertextual. Doesn't have any kind of what organic unity. Yes. So once again, I repeat that the title is taken. The second section title is taken from Thomas Middleton tragedy, Women, Beware of Women. Why? A Game of Chess. Let me tell you the logic behind Game of Chess. Why the section is given such a title? Game of Chess. Okay. So yeah, the story. In Game of Chess, a lady is playing, a lady named Livia is playing chess with old widow. Actually, Livia is assisting a duke, a rich duke. She is helping the rich duke to seduce the daughter-in-law of the old lady. So Livia, who is the assistant or the servant or someone who is helping a duke to get his lady of attention. Okay. Livia plays chess with old lady. At the same time, lady's daughter-in-law, okay, her name is Bianca. Old lady, Bianca, she was seduced by the Duke at the balcony. Okay. So each move that they make on the board ironically represents, I mean, the move taken, steps taken by the Duke at the balcony. Here, when she checkmate the old lady, Livia checkmate the old lady, or when she removes the pawns one by one, pieces on the board one by one, Duke is actually seducing her daughter-in-law at balcony. So here, game of chess is played as a kind of distraction. She's playing game of chess so as to distract the lady, so that she will never come to know about the fact that her daughter-in-law is being seduced by the Duke. So, women, beware of women. A game of chess. A game of chess is actually a trap to seduce that beautiful lady. It is from that story only Eliot has borrowed the second title of his second section. Now, third section, Fire Sermon. So, Fire Sermon, from the title itself, it is taken from Buddha's Eightfold Path. Buddha's Eightfold Path. Okay. Anyway, the philosophy that he used in Fire Sermon is akin to or similar to Saint Augustine's philosophy, Western asceticism. So both Buddha and Saint Augustine believed that suffering, passion is the source of suffering, or our desire is the root cause of all our suffering. Isn't it? We commit sin because of our desire. And that leads us to ultimate misery. So if we don't have any kind of desire or passion, we will not become what? Dismay. Okay. So it is from that fire sermon. Fire sermon is taken from Buddha's Eightfold Path, the title. Okay. So he combines both philosophy here, Western and Eastern. Now, again, I have just told you the philosophy used here. Now, coming to fire sermon, now, our narrator, that is Tiresias, he is now sitting beside a river, and the river is just shown as lifeless. See, in Spencer's Epithalamion, let me tell you something. I hope you still remember, in Spencer's Epithalamion, Thames is represented as a very beautiful river, isn't it? We know that London City is located upon by the side of Thames, isn't it? Which is very beautiful, very lively. But here, Thames is represented as lifeless or decay. Why? Rats are dragging the skeleton of skeletons. And here, the narrator is fishing. And at that moment, he thinks about his brother and father, and he addresses them as king, my brother, king, my father. So here he is alluding to that myth of Holy Grail. I've already told you the myth of Fisher King. Fisher King and his soldiers, they are very licentious. Okay. they are very lustful. Due to their evil ways, both the king and the land have become barren, infertile. Okay. They are suffering. The people are quarreling against one another. They have lost happiness, no harvest, etc. So the solution offered for the infertility is to bring back Holy Grail used by the Jesus Christ, the mythical Holy Grail. Okay. Anyway, that episode is also connected here. Here, our Tiresias narrator is sitting by the side of a river and he's fishing. At that moment only, he called, King, my brother, King, my father. There only he connects that story. I mean, Fisher King's episode. Please note that. Okay. So anyway, narrator is badly, he was distracted by the scene where he can see the lake is full of naked dead bodies and scattered bones. Okay. Now, in this section, in game of chess, their woman has actually become she has become a victim. Okay. Now, in this section, women has willingly given themselves to their partners, not out of love, but because of their difficult situation. So women in this episode are more or less passive or indifferent players. They are making love not out of love, but because of their situation. In second section, she doesn't actually, Bianca, that lady doesn't know that she is going to be assaulted by the Duke. And the highborn lady, even after making love, she's not happy. No one has compelled her to make love. She has got all sort of facilities. Still, after making love, she complains of her bad nerve. She's not happy. And in second section, the lady from low suburbs of London, she makes love, so has to get love from her husband. For that reason, no one has compelled them. But here, they were forced to make love because of their miserable living condition. So in this section, Boy says that Thames River has become polluted. Water in the Thames River has become polluted. Previously, in Chaucer's epithalamium, it is its water was very much pure. I hope you remember in Prothalamium and Epithalamium, he has discussed so many nymphs who are attending his wife and those elegant ladies who are discussed that who are portrayed as those ladies are as white as the snow upon the top of Mount Olympus, etc. But these ladies are not that pure or as white as snow. These ladies are tainted. They are spoiled. They are impure. And the water in the river Thames has become polluted because these modern nymphs means prostitutes. Okay. Modern nymphs or the modern ladies have taken a bath in the river as a result of their impurities. The river Thames have become polluted. Okay. So that is the episode that is conveyed in Fire Sermon. So it is the desire. Actually, who is polluting them? Actually, all these ladies, they don't have any desire to get to become improfane or impure. It is due to the circumstance. It is the society that is actually polluting them, isn't it? It's society that pollutes. So it is the desire in men that leading them to misery or sufferings. Yes. Now, and it also talks about the, I told you this is not coherent. So in the here and there, you can see different types of details have been incorporated. It also talks about the Queen Elizabeth and Leicester's illicit relationship. Okay. Now you can also see that, our Tiresias has been invited by another merchant in London. And while he is having a coffee, his attention was taken, attention was drawn to a hotel where a lady, a typist lady, is waiting for her lover. Actually, she doesn't have any kind of love towards that man. And the young man, he has been addressed as Carbuncle. Not that tidy. And she waits for that Carbuncle lover. Tiresias is sitting in a restaurant with a merchant. At that time, his attention is drawn towards a nearby building where a poor typist girl is waiting for her young lover, and she is having love with him. She involves with him without any feelings. And after attaining, after getting some satisfaction, the lover leaves from there. A lady continues her work. She's not happy. She's not sad. She doesn't have any kind of feeling. She's very mechanical. So the Fire Sermon shows the desire in men. And all these ladies are engaging in sex, but they are not happy. They are not getting any pleasure from it. Okay. So ultimately it says that desire is the root cause of suffering or evil. Now, moving on to death by water. Last section. Let me check the time. So, death by water. In this section, I have already told you, water has got a ritualistic importance in all religion, isn't it? We Hindus use it. We consider water of the holy Ganga, isn't it? Water of the river Ganga has holy, and we use, we sprinkle it whenever we have some kind of ritualistic, when we have some kind of ceremonies, obviously we sprinkle it, isn't it? In Christianity also, in Muslims, in all religion, water has got ritualistic importance. So apart from that, we can see that, death by water, let's discuss that. After that, I will explain the point. So in the first section, you have seen that Madame Sorceress has drawn a card where Phoenician sailor is drowned to death, isn't it? And she says to Tiresias that he will have a death by water. So here, it is the shortest session in the poem. Okay, here the Phlebas is the Phoenician sailor. Yeah, he is seen floating on the water. So here, as said, has mentioned, even though she said it in a in general, it has actually come true that the particular person has dead by water. And let me tell you, Phoenician sailor is now deprived of his lust. He is now deprived of all his sins because water has cleansed him. Previously, see, he was full of sin, lust for profit, sensual pleasures. Was very much materialistic. Our Phoenician sailor was very much materialistic. But once he had a death by water, water has cleansed his lust from his body, bones, flesh. Water has cleansed him. Like that, he has become pure. Okay. So in this section, he is, writer T.S. Eliot is informing the reader that, see, we know that the result or the one you get for all your sins and your crime is death. Now, what the thunder said, part 5. So this is particularly, the philosophy is taken from Indian Upanishad, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Thread is taken from Indian Upanishad. So in last four sections, he talked, P.S. Eliot talked about the very futility, vanity in the 20th century society. But here, he presents water as something that saves humankind. After having a death by water, now human society, humankind has been cleansed. Now they have achieved that purgation. All their sins have been washed away. Okay. Now, what the thunder said? Now, thunder is giving some kind of advice for the modern man is giving, thunder is giving some advice to the modern people. Let's see. So once again, he's presenting London city, which is unreal. He says that again, it is unreal. The city will crumble down anytime. The entire world has become very much barren, not only human beings, but their feelings, physically, mentally, they have become barren. We have become barren. Okay. So suddenly, after mentioning the present situation of the London city, entire European continent, TSA says that it's full of the stony places, no water, nothing. Okay. After that, he make a sudden switch. He makes a sudden switch to Eastern philosophy. That is, from River Thames, he suddenly moves to River Ganga. He says that, I already told you, the solution he offers for the spiritual decadence or spiritual degradation is to turn towards the Eastern philosophy. You have a lot of stuff to learn from the Eastern philosophy. He says that, go back to the Vedas and Upanishads. So he incorporates a nursery song here, London Bridge is falling down. Okay, he ends this poem with Sanskrit mantra, Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. And apart from that, he has also taken, let me tell you, three phrases, Datta, Dayatvam, and Damyata. These three phrases are taken from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. So this is the advice given by thunder to the modern man. Okay. If you want to if he wants salvation, or if he wants redemption, or a spiritual upliftment, you should observe these three things. Datta. Datta means to give. Charity. To give. Now, Dayatvam. Be compassionate. You have to be compassionate with your fellow beings. Now, next one is Dhammyata. Dhammyata means self-control. You have to control yourself. So these three are the advice given by Thunder to the modern man. Actually, let me tell you, this episode is taken from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, where the Prajapati, or the creator, when he is asked by his progeny, that is God, men and demons, isn't it? Prajapati has got threefold progeny, gods, human beings and demons. When they ask for an advice for a perpetual life, for a happy life, if you want to have a happy, contented life, then you have to observe these three things. What? Datta, Dayatvam and Dhammyata. Datta means give, Dayatvam means to be compassionate, and Dhammyata means self-control. So, with this, what the Thunder said comes to an end. The fifth session comes to an end. So, let me tell you, this wasteland is full of images. Because I have told you, T.S. Eliot believes that a good poem will have a sense of what? Unification of sensibility. It doesn't matter how much that poem is fragmented, but you're able to associate this poem, isn't it? Even though he presented many images in this poem, all these images show a single thing, that rebirth is impossible. People are fertile. Both the people and the land are equally fertile. Now, love has lost its importance. Turn towards East. Eastern philosophy. So these are the things that is conveyed in Wasteland. Now, one more thing. So the objective correlate, the three main objective correlate is the images, is the journey to Emmaus. So after the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, see, Jesus Christ has already informed his 11 disciples. The remaining disciple, that is 11, he has to, before his crucifixion, he has told them that to go around the world and to spread the philosophy. So after his crucifixion, while they were waiting for his resurrection, two of his disciples, they were traveling to Emmaus. So actually, they believe that Jesus Christ will resurrect. So they are so eager to see the Jesus Christ. But actually, Jesus Christ was also with them. But they couldn't identify Jesus Christ on the way. But later they identify on the way to Emmaus, they identify that is one of the image. Then the approach of the chapel of Perilous. I told you Fisher King and his knights were in search of that holy grail that bring youth, longevity, fertility. That is the next image. Then it presents the decay of Eastern Europe. So these are the three images. It is basically through three images that Eliot builds his poem Wasteland. Even though there are so many images, it has got a single theme, that is temporal world. Present world is falling down. You can revive it if you have faith in God. If you have faith, then you can revive it. You can bring it back to life. So that's all about Wasteland. Let me tell you. Hello, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we have done with Wasteland. Now moving on to William Butler. It's very easy. Okay, William Butler is an Irish poet. He's the one who has founded Abbey Theatre. Abbey Theatre is Irish National Theatre. He found Abbey Theatre along with Lady Gregory in 1904. Okay, so he was also a senator of the Irish Free State. Now, he's a freedom fighter, but he is not active, but a passive fighter. Now, let me tell you, he was not that brilliant in painting or in schools. Okay, he believed in, he secretly learned magic. He spent his days alone in Ireland while his father and mom left for England. Okay, later they joined him. Now, in 1923, he won Nobel Prize in literature. Then, let me tell you, he is termed as he is believed to be the last of the Romantic poets. Now, even though he's an early 20th century writer, he still maintained the tradition of Romantic writers and Pre-Raphaelite poets. More or less, his writings are similar to that of William Blake. William Blake is a mystic poet, isn't it? William Blake is a mystic poet. He has got his own philosophy. Similarly, our William Blake also has got his own philosophy. Okay. He has got many images. His poems are also esoteric. Only a well-learned scholar can understand his poem deeply. Now, yeah. So I told you he was born in Dublin. He secretly learned magic. Then he was a member of a secret society. Now he declined knighthood. Now he loved a lady named Morgan, but she declined his love, and she has become his subject for many poems. Okay, now anything else? Yeah. So characteristics of his poetry: he's a mystic poet. He has we have discussed that point. So I'm just concluding. I told you that he's the last of the Romantics because he has got his own philosophy, love for nature. He related. He described nature with all its sensual qualities. Now. But he maintained some kind of order. Unlike other modern writers, his poems has got some kind of order, stateliness, and control. That is why he is said to be the last of the Romantics. Now, yes. And he also believed in originality and position. Now, symbolism. Just like any other 20th century writers, he mostly expressed his ideas through symbols like Jair. He presented a conical type of image in his poem. Two or three poems, he has presented a corn made of so many rings. A corn made of many rings. Then swans, rose. So all these images are repeated in his poems. Okay. Now, artistry. Now, I told you this man is very sensual, sentimental. He has mixed his personal feeling in this poetry. Now, Easter 1916. Let me complete this poem. So, Easter 1916 is based on a Easter rebellion happened in 1916, April 24. So we know that Ireland and England were not in good terms. Ireland was under British rule. So many British people have told them that they will offer in home rule if they support them in First World War. So Ireland at that time was divided into two groups. One is aristocratic, men of letters. That is, they were aristocratic people. Our William Butler belonged to aristocratic people, men of letters. And another group is revolutionary people. Okay, so these revolutionary people, they were very impatient. They couldn't, they didn't wait until the end of First World War. But they unleashed riot in Dublin city in 1916. on a Easter day, they were able to capture, I mean, they were able to recapture the, Dublin city. But after some days, all these revolutionaries were captured and executed by the British people. So anyway, until then, these people were mocked by the aristocratic peoples. Let me tell you, aristocratic people and men and revolutionaries both are striving to attain same thing, that is independence or home rule for Ireland. Okay, but British people, British, told them that they will give them home rule or independence only if they assist them in the First World War. But revolutionaries were not pretty happy with that idea. They have dropped that contract and they have unleashed a war upon British in 1960, April 24. Let me tell you, I told you that William Butler East fell in love with a lady named Morgan. She has rejected his love and she married a drunken lord. He was also a revolutionary. Okay, MacBride. His name is MacBride, John MacBride. So, yeah, he too was executed during this Irish rebellion. I mean, Easter uprising. Okay, so this, the main theme or the background of this poem is Easter rebellion. Okay, so I have met them at the close of the day, coming with vivid faces from counter desk among the gray 18th century houses. I have passed with a nod of head or polite meaningless word. So here in this Easter 1916, he is very sad because he has lost his lady love and she has married a revolutionary. East is William Butler East is aristocrat. He's an aristocrat. Okay, so anyway, both revolutionaries and aristocrats has believed in the same thing, but their approach were different. I have met them at the close of the day. That means William Butler East, who was an aristocrat, he used to meet those revolutionaries coming out of the 18th century houses. Obviously, there were a lot of party houses during that time. So they joined during evening and by the break of the day, by the end of the day, they will come out. So when they come out of the respective buildings, East has met those revolutionaries. And obviously, they have exchanged many greetings, sometimes polite, meaningless words. And East thought that, see, those people, those revolutionaries were leading a simple life as that of William Butler East and his friends. So they will exchange some kind of greeting, and later, after meeting them, when he goes back to his club, he used to ridicule them. He used to make fun of them to please a companion. So as to please his companion around the fire, he used to mimic them, being certain that I am, being certain that they and I, but believe were mortally is one. William Butler East and other aristocrats thought that revolutionaries were living a similar kind of life as that of them. Okay, but their concept, their thought has completely shattered on that particular day, on that Easter day of 1916, because they unleashed the terrible war upon British. And all change, all their concept or thought about the revolutionary has changed. Why? Because they sacrificed their life for the mother country. All these aristocrats, they were aristocrats for the namesake. They couldn't sacrifice or they couldn't do anything for the Ireland. But these revolutionaries who were until then were tagged or marked as drunken lords, capable of doing no greater things, has done something great for their country. That is, they have sacrificed their life. So he says that a terrible beauty is born. Terrible and beauty. Beauty is a positive thing, a terrible is a negative thing. So that is an oxymoron here. Okay. One second. Let me take the poem. Yeah. So this is the first stanza of the poem. So in the second stanza, anyway, I have included the notes here. I will share it in the group. So in the second stanza, he says that See, there were many revolutionaries in the group. One was a woman. Her name was Constance McAvey's. She was very beautiful and young. She joined this men. She traveled on a horse. See, due to a heated argument during night time, her voice has grown more husky. Okay. Previously, her voice sound was very sweet. Now her voice has become very sharp. Then another person, this poem is very simple. Another person is, one second. I have included the names here. This man who kept a school. Another person was Patrick Pierce. In the poem, this man had kept a school and rode our winged horse. This other is his helper and friend was coming to horse. Okay. So another person he mentions in the poem is Patrick Pierce. He had a school and he rode the swiftest horse. And the third person is Thomas McDonough, is the assistant and helper of Patrick Pierce. He was an upcoming poet, a budding poet. He was very sweet, daring, and sensitive poet. And the fourth man is none other than John McBride. John McBride even though she married John McBride after 2 years, she had broken with him. John McBride, until then, he was a drunken brag. But on that particular day, he has become a hero by sacrificing his life for his country. Okay, so in the third stanza, William Butler Yeats praises the sacrifice of these revolutionaries. Okay, see, everything in nature changes. The very course, of the horse, flight of the bird, hens, clouds, water, stream, etc. Is changing. But if there remains something unchanged, then it is the heart of these revolutionaries. The heart of these revolutionary has become a stone because they are working for a noble cause. In their sleep and while they are awake and when they are sleeping, they have only one thought, that is freedom for Ireland. Okay, so that has become their dream, and that has turned their heart into a stone. Okay. So this is an ambiguous poem. Even though Yeats doesn't like John McBride because he has stolen his lady love from him after his sacrifice for the country, now he is full of awe and respect for the revolutionaries. So I told you this is an ambiguous poem because he says that whether this sacrifice is an apt one, whether it was a need of the time, he says that it wasn't that necessary because British people has offered them independence, home rule. They could have waited for it, but their step was really an impatient one. What really an impetuous one. They could have waited. Still, he praises the very attempt of the revolutionary. That is the very theme of the Eastern 1916. Now, next poem is Sailing to Byzantium. Sailing to Byzantium is a very beautiful poem. It's once again, he discusses the very spiritual degradation of the European civilization. The poem is written in octava rima. Eight lines in iambic pentameters, and it has got the following rhyming scheme: A, B, A, B, A, B, B, C, C. Okay. So Byzantium is a it is see Byzantium is a journey is a it's like it's a mythical place, just like Constantinople, Italy. We know that Constantinople is a learning place in Italy. One second, just a second. Hello. So Constantinople is a learning place in Italy. It was destroyed by Turks in 1453. So similarly, Byzantium is similar to that. See, origin. I mean, in ancient mythology, it is a origin of Christianity. So here, William Butler East is making a journey to. He's traveling to Byzantium. Yeah, and he is also. There is also one more theme in this poem, that is transience of life versus permanence of art. Okay. So the here, it is a metaphoric journey to the life after death, a metaphorical journey of life after death, so has to embrace the paradise. Now, so many writers were influenced by these poems. So many titles and Brahma's poems, novels have been written after sailing to Byzantium. Now, sailing to Byzantium, I told you, it is a place where the really Christianity has been originated. Major seat of early Christianity, the place where everyone comes so has to attain salvation or eternity. Okay, now art is one of the important themes. Now, yeah, because question of mortality and immortality has been explained here. According to writer William Butler East, our body, flesh, blood, etc. are just a covering, just a dress to our soul. Soul is the actual body and blood, flesh, etc. are dress, attire. Okay, so inevitability of death, and it talks about immortality then. Okay, one second. So some says that it's a prayer to sailing to Byzantium. Some writers like John Crow Ramsden says that it's a kind of prayer written to sages. Okay, some says that it's written in a tension between memory and desire, knowledge and intuition, and nature and history. Okay, some says that it's a kind of a spiritual revolt between spiritual materialistic position and spiritual position. You can be happy in two ways, isn't it? For some by attaining spiritual upliftments, for some by attaining material things. Now, sailing to Byzantium, he says that, see, that is no, okay, there is no much time for us. So that is no country for old men, the young men in one another's arm, birds in trees, those dying generation at their song, salmon, falls, mackerel, crowded seas, fish, flesh, or fowl, all summer long, whatever is begotten, born, and dies, caught in that sensual music, all neglect and monuments of unaging intellect. So, you see, in this poem, the first stanza, William Butler A says that this is no country for old men. See, England or Europe or entire world is not a country for old men. Okay, old man has no value in this country. He is just a tattered coat upon a stick. This is not a country for elderly people. See, all are happy. See, songbirds are singing, fishes are swimming, animals are living their own life. Other young people are making love. They are happy in their own way. But for an elderly person, if he has to be happy, or he needs to teach his soul to sing and to clap the hand. Soul has to be happy. If he has to be alive in the modern society, then his soul has to be happy. So this is not a place for elderly people. So has to attain eternity after death. His soul is sailing to holy city of Byzantium. Okay, I mean the city of sages, the city of gods. Okay. So first stanza we have discussed. The second stanza he says that, see, Byzantium is a city of many sages. So before him, many sages have, long dead in that place. Now they are just like a golden tile that decorates in the churches of Byzantium. So he is asking those early sages, hermits, ascetics, to teach him to sing, not teach him to sing, but his soul to sing. According to William Butler East, our body is just a dress. Original state of being is soul. So what if one has to be happy, the soul has to be happy. So he is invoking those long dead sages, so has to teach him to sing. His body is failing him. He has many diseases. So all kind of diseases has affected his body. Free moments of So he is asking them to make him or teach him to sing. Now, in the last stanza, we can see that he says that he doesn't want to take a physical birth again. He doesn't want to be in physical form again. If he ever takes a birth on earth, then he has to become a piece of art. He has to become a golden piece of art, the one that is created by the metal workers in ancient Greece. So has to hang in the bedroom of emperor, or else he wants to become a songbird, and he wants to sit on a golden tree so that he can sing and preach the people about otherworldly wisdom, because whatever things we see, have, experience in this world is temporary. That won't give you any kind of satisfaction, happy, or spirituality. The true life starts after the death. That is, one has to sail to Byzantium, so has to attain the greater knowledge. That is what is conveyed in Sailing to Byzantium. No Second Troy is a very interesting poem. The subject of this poem is Morgan. We have already discussed about Morgan, that she was his lover and married to John McBride. Published in 1921. Now, let's see this poem. Why should I blame her for that she filled my days with misery, or that she would of late? So in this poem, he says that there is no point to blame her. He argues that he shouldn't blame her because she has declined his love. And she taught other innocent men violent ways. See, actually, this is an indirect type of attack upon Morgan. See, William Butler Ace is full of despair, anger, because Morgan has rejected him and married John McBride. So he says that he shouldn't blame her for rejecting him and for teaching innocent men the violent ways to attain independence. She is the one, because she married a revolutionary, right? And she herself was a revolutionary. And she also brought so many innocent people upon the street. They shouldn't blame her, because she has worked for a noble cause, isn't it? At least she has worked for the country. The nobleness made the simple has fire. Maybe her aim has made her a firebrand or a firestuff. Now she is a titan bow. Beauty like a titan bow, a kind that is not natural in an age like this. And he says that she doesn't belong to this age. She is very beautiful, but she is really tough. She's at the same time, she is beautiful and tough. She is some kind of a fire element, a firebrand. She belongs to another era. How one can be so high and solitary and so serious in this present age? She belongs to aristocracy, but still has her own way, and she's very serious. How one can be all these at the same time? So she doesn't belong to the present century. She belongs to some other century. She is actually more similar to that of Helen. I hope you remember Helen of Troy. Helen was the queen of Menelaus, the king of Sparta, isn't it? She was abducted by Paris Trojan, who was a Trojan. And see, Menelaus, along with his warriors, went to Troy. They got her back after burning Troy, after destroying Troy. So who was the reason for destroying Troy? Helen, isn't it? It's for the pursuit of Helen. Odysseus, Achilles, Menelaus, etc. went to Troy. And the root reason for the destruction, it is, isn't it? You will learn in British drama, in Christoph Marlowe's Dr. Faustus, you will learn that. Was this that phase that launched 1,000 ships? It is after Helen they have made that. It's for Helen that they made that biggest conquest. So, see, Helen has resulted in such a, she has caused such a disaster. Similarly, this lady has resulted in, she has caused many disasters in Ireland. But let me tell you, she can't be the second Helen. Why? Ireland can be the second Troy, because she has many other things to destroy. Say, like, she has already broken the heart of the poet. And she has already destroyed the life of innocent people. See, when Helen destroyed the city of Troy, just not Helen, of course, her husband and followers, but she has become a cause to destroy the Troy and its people, isn't it? Similarly, our Morgan has become a reason for breaking the heart of the poet, as well as so many innocent people has lost their life. So here, he compares Morgan to that of Helen, but she doesn't have a second Troy to destroy. Ireland is not a second Troy. Instead, she has destroyed William Butler East. Now, Adam's curse. One second, I will complete the poem very soon. Adam curse, the title is very interesting. Here also the three themes has been explored, that is writing, hard work, and unreciprocated love and time. Okay, so yeah, the structure of the poem is, the poem is somewhat a sonnet type. First, there are three stanzas. Okay, and there are 19 couplets in total. So yeah, we sat together at one summer and that beautiful mild woman and your close friend, and you and I talk of poetry. Okay, so in the first stanza, poet that with William Butler East, his lover and lover's friend, they are sitting together and they are talking about the very compilation of the poetry, the labor behind compilation of the labor behind writing poetry. He says that poetry writing is a very hard task. It's like stitching and unstitching. You will put one word there, thereafter you will the next moment you will think that the word is not fit for that purpose, you will remove it. So it is somewhat like stitching and unstitching. So after compiling the poetry, when you read it, you will feel that, oh, the person might have compiled in a second, but for writing that single line, he might have taken so many days or years. Okay, so he says that scrubbing the kitchen or doing or breaking the stones or any other manual labors are far better and easier than writing poetry. But poets will not get that kind of honor or reward from people, because they think that this job is very easy. Okay, so that is what is mentioned in the first stanza. In second stanza, you will see that his beloved, in second stanza, the beloved says that, see, being a woman is also a difficult job, just like poetry writing. People will think that, oh, it's very easy, very beautiful to look at a woman, isn't it? It is very beautiful to read a poem, isn't it? You will feel very good to read a poem. But similarly, you will also feel some kind of happiness when you see a beautiful woman. But women are actually taking a lot of pain to be beautiful. Okay, so yes. So in this poem, he says that, see, if a thing is not attained by hard work, then it will have no value. It will not be great if it is not attained by hard work. That means if you're loving a person, you will have to put a lot of effort. You will have to put yourself, your heart and soul into it to become fruitful. Isn't it? He's working a lot. Both the lover and beloved are working a lot to make that relation work. Isn't it? Similarly, to become beautiful, to remain beautiful, a woman will have to work a lot. Maybe even if she wants to eat a lot of stuff, she cannot eat it. She has to maintain her figure like that. You are working a lot. So second stanza is built upon the, I told you, the poem has got three themes. First theme is hard work. Second theme is poetry writing. And third theme is unreciprocated love. Okay. Yeah. So second stanza. And third stanza, he says that all these three people are looking at the moon. And he says that moon, he compares the moon to that of the sun, seashell washed by the sea water. So both the sea and the moon are cleansed. But his love remains unreciprocated. So love is such a thing. Love has become such a mysterious thing or such a unreal thing that one has to look and one has to dig deep down, so has to see it. If even if you work a lot, it is difficult to attain true love, because he loved Morgan a lot, but still he lost her. Yes. Now, next poem is Lapis Lazuli, the last one in the series. So Lapis Lazuli is actually, see this poem, he has written this poem inspired by the gift he got from Harry Clifton. That is a Chinese vessel. A semi-precious stone. Now, so that carving, and anyway, that gift has got three pictures on it. That is three people, two Chinese men and the servant. One could be an ascetic, one could be a scholar, another one his disciple, and another one is a servant who's carrying the stuff of the ascetic and the disciple. Then you can see a small house, then mountain and some trees near to that house. Okay, so let's see. It's a very interesting poem. Okay, so Lapis Lazuli. I have heard the hysterical women say they are sick of ballet and fiddle bow, of poets and that are always gay. Everybody knows or else should know that if nothing drastic is done, aeroplanes, zeppelin will come out and pitch like King Billy Bomb balls in until the town lay beaten flat. So Lapis Lazuli is a modern poem where he presents the paranoid, hysteric characters. I have already mentioned you, the present characters are hysteric. So he says that it is dedicated, this poem is dedicated to Harry Clifton, who has gifted him that Chinese ware made of Lapis Lazuli. Okay, it's Lapis Lazuli carving. It's a carving of Lapis Lazuli. So he says that, see, while men are having fun, so many hysteric women, they are not happy. And they say that, see, they are so afraid of the palette. They are so afraid of the beautiful things. Okay, when some beautiful things come or some happy occasion comes, they are not able to have fun of it. They are not able to celebrate it. Why? Because anything can happen at the next moment, isn't it? Just like what had happened in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Because at any time, aeroplane and zeppelin will drop bombs. Just like they had dropped in the Battle of Boyer. And they will destroy the town into dust. Okay. In second stanza, he says that, see, modern men have lot of things to learn from the Shakespearean characters. King Lear, Cordelia, Hamlet, etc. are tragic characters of Shakespeare. And characters know that they will, I mean, actors who have enacted those epic roles, they know that they will be killed at the end of the drama or some part of the play, and that their role will come to an end. But still they are enacting it without engaging in it deeply. So, they should be taken as a model. Now, in the third part of the poem, he says that, see, our world has witnessed many civilization, Egyptian, Indian, Aztec, Mayan, Mesopotamian, many civilizations. Some has come on horseback, some has come on camel, some have come by ship, like that. See, so we have seen so many invaders, colonizers, and a lot of people have been colonized. This is a world of colonizers and colonized, like that. So, so many civilizations have been created, constructed, and destroyed. So, destruction and creation. So, these are ongoing process. Okay. These are ongoing process. We cannot do anything with it. So, there have been many structures, painters. See, one Callimachus, he has created so many. He has sculpted many beautiful sculptures, but it has none of his sculptures are existing today. But see, we human beings, we are able to recreate things far better than that have existed, isn't it? I mean, see, previous, we have a lot of world wonders, but our science and technology have advanced a lot. Even though we have lost a lot of things, we are capable, far more capable than our ancestors, and we are able to replenish it with even more better things. Okay, so he says that if the lost thing can be recreated, if those lost sculptures, civilization, or buildings, or if the lost things have been recreated, I mean, the person or the people who have recreated, they can be happy again, isn't it? Modern men are not happy. Modern people are not happy, even though they are in the middle of all kind of facilities, luxuries. See, here in the first stanza itself, while men are having fun, hysteric women, they are not happy. They are not able to have fun out of it. Why? Because they are afraid that any time bombs or aeroplane may drop in that, aeroplane or zeppelin may drop bomb in that area. So they are always anxious, worried. So there is no need to be anxious or worried like that. If your creation can be recreated, you can be happy again. Okay. So one more second. Just a second. Yes. So this is the main theme of lapis lazuli. So whatever thing we have lost, we are able to revive it. Just like William Wordsworth, he says that we have got that capacity to replenish with even more beautiful thing, with even more better things. Okay, so that's all about the 9th block. Anyway, you may please go through these slides. I have incorporated all details. I will share it in the group. Okay, one second. Are you people still there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am. Okay. Okay then. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. You people have any idea which group will, ma'am, will share this slide?
Which group is in? Can you please add me? Or give me the link?
Yeah, me too.
Hello, please help us. Give us the link. We'll join the group.
Please pay attention. It is a link by RC Cochin Ignu. Okay, in that she shares, but then I think that that group is full. You may not be in a position to join in that group. So if you are there,
then
students.